The sun.
And together we are
Family Plot.
Very nice, very nice. Let's get the housekeeping out of the way real quick. First and foremost, if you want to help support us, you can do that through Patreon. There you only have two levels, the $1 and the $3. You get different things at each level, and we really appreciate the support. Now, if you can't do a monthly donation, you can always do a one-time donation through Buy Me a Coffee of a dollar or two. If you enjoy the show, please share it on social media.
Share it with family.
With everyone.
And if you don't enjoy the show, please
keep it to yourself.
Like we always say, if you don't have anything nice to say,
don't say anything at all.
Exactly.
Yes, we have to remind you of that frequently, Dad.
Yep. So what are we talking about tonight? Well, tonight we go back to 1867 to attend the birth of Marie Slobodowska Curie, who is better known today as Marie Curie.
Madame Curie, even.
And Madame Curie, even. We dig into the life of this Polish-born scientist and teacher, the only person to get a Nobel Prize in two separate fields, or rather I should say the first, because I guess someone has done it since. The first person to win two Nobel Prizes, the first woman to receive a Nobel Prize, and one half of the first married couple to ever get a Nobel Prize. In this Man, I Love Girl Power History episode of the Family Plot Podcast.
Yeah. So what are you going to pour us about? Are you going to give us some background?
Yep.
Also, were we going to save it to the end? We were talking about, we're still working on a contest for September for Patreon, right? Before we get too far into the episode.
Yes.
Seeing as our next episode will drop when we are actually in September, I wanted to bring it up one more time so people can be thinking about joining our Patreon.
There you go. That's very smart. So, she was born November 7th of 1867 in Warsaw, in what was then the Kingdom of Poland, which was part of the Russian Empire.
So, did they see the war?
Which war?
Ha ha.
It was a bad pun.
It was really bad.
See the war. Got it. I think Warsaw is Polish for, we live here. Probably not, but I guess.
We're just guessing.
We're not gonna ask Dan what he thinks of the Polish either.
Yeah. She was well known for her prodigious memory and her intelligence.
See, I could be much more intelligent if I had a great memory. I haven't had even a decent memory since 1994. So.
Now, her father was a secondary education teacher who often helped his daughter.
Feel too long ago, though.
She was educated at local schools at the Russian Lycée and was awarded a gold medal for her grades.
Excellent.
Yeah.
I wish.
She got into teaching, giving some of her money to her sister, Bronislava. And that may be pronounced Bronislava. I found it both ways, so I'm not sure. So she could attend school in France. She read to women workers in Polish, both teaching and learning, as part of Poland's flying university, a clandestine educational situation in Poland.
Excellent.
In 1891, she went to Paris, where she began to study at the Sorbonne. The Sorbonne is a well-known university in Paris, France. At the Sorbonne, she attended the lectures of famed French mathematician Paul Appel, French physicist Gabriel Lippmann, and French physicist Edmond Bouty, while meeting already accomplished physicists like French geophysicist Charles Morin, French physicist known for his work with light, Amy Cotton, and Jean-Baptiste Perrin, who commanded a starship. Oh, wait, no. That was Jean-Luc Picard. This is Jean-Baptiste Perrin, who earned a Nobel Prize for confirming Einstein's theories about the atomic nature of matter with his own experiments dealing with objects suspended in liquid and studying their resulting motion. It was in this atmosphere that young Marie began to absorb science, physics, math, and chemistry. She lived either at the Sorbonne itself or in her small garret apartment, where her studies were mostly fueled by bread and butter and tea.
Nice.
Yummy.
Sounds good to me. She worked late into the night, and in 1893 received her licence in physical sciences, placing first in her class. A licence is roughly equivalent to the American bachelor degree.
Nice.
She began to work in Lippmann's research lab, and a year later earned her licence in mathematics. Nice. She came in second in her class for that degree.
So it's kind of like a license, but it's spelled different and said different.
So in there, they're saying the licence is...
licence.
It's like, it's a degree.
Right.
So.
That's excellent. So, guess what?
Hear ye, hear ye! Allow me to present Arthur's Corner.
It's my corner time.
Yep.
But today we have a special thanks to someone.
Aww.
It's to Mother.
Aww.
Because today, well, I don't think that we're supposed to be playing Minecraft.
Not right now.
Not at the moment.
Here we go. Is that better?
Yeah. We're good. Hold on, I need to see. Can I? Nope. That's gonna...
Yeah, just that's where you want it over there. It should... There you
go. Oh, okay. Okay. We have a special thanks to Mother because she did the research. I'm just the one speaking it. And that is because I had a long day at school today. And she wanted to help me. So,
I always like to help my babies.
And today we are talking about the... Oh, wait. Before we get into it. How are we doing today?
I almost forgot. I am having a day. Today would have been my uncle's 65th birthday, I believe. Unfortunately, he passed away right before COVID, like lockdown, due to ALS. So help fund research. It's a terrible disease. We hate that we lost him so very young. He has grandchildren who miss him, and obviously niece and a son and daughter who miss him very much. So I've kind of had a sad day, but I'm not going to let that mess us up. How about you, Daddy?
I'm okay. I got a lot done today. I got notes for next week's shows done. I got... I got some stuff filled out for the state. I got your stuff for the show you're going to be doing.
Ding gag.
Yeah. I got that edited. Got that edited and sent off. This Sunday afternoon, we're scheduled to be on a podcast. I believe it's 87.9 WKCUR, but it's a game. It's a trivia game that we're going to play with this other podcast. And when you
that's
get
so exciting,
yeah. So that'll be this Saturday. So
I'm not very good at trivia.
Sunday.
That's a Sunday. You have an exciting weekend this weekend too, right?
Yeah, I'm gonna go have a hangout day with somebody that mom got me. in
another kind of extended family member that we have, a member of our fam out in the world there that shares a lot of interest.
A member of our non-biological family.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely. Like our listeners. So, excellent. Well, you go right ahead. The corner is yours, sir.
The corner is mine. Okay, today we will be talking about the differences between moths and butterflies. Let's first talk about a little bit about activity. Butterflies are usually active during the day, which is called diurnal.
Diurnal.
Yes. It's called diurnal. While most moths are active at night, which is nocturnal, as most people know.
If you talk about their antennas, we can tell the difference between butterflies and moths most of the time with their antennas. What does that look like?
Most definitely. Antennas, butterfly antennae are usually long and knobby. Like, long and either knobby on the end or straight.
Excellent.
So, like...
So when you see the...
When you see a butterfly, you'll either see its antenna as, like, a long...
With a little ball at the end.
With
like
a little ball at the end. Or it'll just be straight.
Right.
Like at the end. It's like actually curved a little bit. There's a curved a little outward so they can like direct themselves and stuff, I'm pretty sure. Mm-hmm. And then moths have shorter, like a little
feathery
antennae.
Yeah, little feathery.
They have little feathery-like antenna. And I love moths.
They're fluffy.
They're foofy. We
love that.
They're foofy little guys.
I never realized that that was an actual difference. I just thought that that was just how they landed, but apparently...
Butterflies rest with their wings closed, while moths rest with their wings open. So when you see a butterfly or a moth, you can tell the difference, well, because the activity and the antenna... But also by the way they land on something. So let's say they land on a flower or they land on the side of your house because everybody knows moths do that all the time, even if butterflies don't usually.
Yep.
You can tell that it's a moth because its wings are laying flat. You can see the design on it. Now, butterflies, you can still see that, but it's usually...
Close.
You can see it to the side more than
like
you can see it.
From time to time while they're resting,
they will open and close their wings.
But they rest with them closed.
But they
and
rest
I
with them
I never realized that. I feel so stupid.
You're not stupid.
I found that on Google and went, it makes sense.
Yeah. I've never seen a moth with its wings closed.
Right.
And I've never seen a butterfly with them open.
Yeah,
exactly.
Absolutely.
So after I read that, I was like, hey, they're absolutely right. I've seen it a gazillion times and just never, it didn't click in my brain.
Doesn't click. That's okay. Sometimes things just don't click, like math problems. Those don't click.
That is true. You absolutely know I don't math.
I math a little bit,
at least. Better than me, for sure. You definitely math better than me.
Anyways, now on to the next one. This is cocoon or chrysalis. Most moths have a silky cocoon. I don't know how they make it.
It looks a little... They have, like, silk spinners in, like, their butts, kind of like spiders. And they wrap it around themselves, right? It's either in their butts or comes out of their mouth,
comes out of their mouth?
I think it depends on the type. But anyway, they create this silken material, and it does look a lot like a spider's, like, egg sac.
Yeah, but it's a little longer, and it doesn't...
It's because you won't remember this, but when we had the house in the Northland, the one we left to go to California in 2013, when we had that, we got a little nest of moths in one of the closets, and they had gotten in and started making cocoons, or started making their cocoons in clothing. And when you opened it up, it looked like a spider's nest or a spider's, because it was this silky little moth cocoon that they had crawled up in there and made their little cocoon inside blankets or whatever was folded in the closet.
No. Don't do that. That's the wrong place to put it.
I know, right? So, we were going to talk about a specific moth today, right?
Well, before we do that, butterflies usually make a shiny chrysalis. So, it's different than if you see a silky, almost spider-like cocoon, that's likely a moth. And a shiny chrysalis, obviously, is a butterfly. We did a... I know it was a long time ago, like, not too terribly long, because obviously I'm not that old, but, a while ago, back in, like, I'm pretty sure it was kindergarten, I did a evolution experiment, and we had this little container sort of thing. It's like, it was like a cloth thing, and... we kept a couple butterflies in there to see the evolution of it.
Very cool.
And we saw the shining chrysalis that it had. I can't remember what butterfly it was for the life of me.
Monarch?
Maybe. It's possible.
That sounds right. That's one of the big ones.
Yeah, in fact, when we lived in Merced, for a while the dollar stores there were carrying those...
butterfly breeding kits.
Yeah, that's what that was, I'm pretty sure.
So, yeah.
Ignore me, I haven't eaten all day. Anyways, today we are talking about a specific type of moth, though, which is called the Rosy Maple Moth.
Clearly, it must be delicious. Pretty,
no.
Which is beautiful.
It's a very beautiful moth.
Not delicious.
Isn't the rosy maple moths the ones that are like yellow and pink?
Yellow and pink, yes. Yeah.
I
all the way up to they can be almost like a magenta in some areas. Not even, yeah. But
yeah, not even like a soft pink. It's like the pink, sort of like the pink we have on the screen, but it's a little darker in some spots.
I found just a little bit of information about them, if you want to share.
Information that Mom had found. The rosy maple moth is a species of small moths from North America, but it's often called the great silk moths. I wonder if their cocoons are, like, very silky.
Well, they probably are, because moths make silky cocoons. Silky cocoons. Do you want to do the source before you go any farther?
Before we go further, Rosy Maple, the source we have is Rosy Maple Moth Facts, Habitat, Diet, Life Cycle, Baby Pictures, animalspot.net.
Yes. So we found this information on animalspot.net. So if you want to see the pictures that we have seen, which are beautiful, go check that out. Look for Rosy Maple Moths and you will find them.
Yeah. All right. Known for their charming and vibrant looks. They definitely are charming and vibrant.
They're beautiful
moths. I love them. The caterpillars of these pink and yellow creatures also have distinct identity with the individual name green-striped maple worm. The moths are also a popular choice in pet trade, which is fine, but also sort of unfortunate, because you know as soon as you get a moth, that moth won't be living for long.
It talks about how long they actually live. They only typically live for about 2 to 9 months. The upper limit comes down to 5 months when they're in captivity.
Yeah.
So they live about half, a little over half the time that they could live in the wild if you keep them as a pet. So that's kind of sad.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. The distribution and range. Rosy maple moths are spread across Nova Scotia West.
Nova Scotia.
Okay, I'm bad. Through Quebec, I know that one, to Ontario, and Minnesota. They are also found to the south throughout Florida, the Gulf Coast,
Dade
County, and the eastern part of Texas. No regional subspecies of this moth has been defined. Now, before we go further, it's so weird. Does it say... Is that, like, through Missouri at all?
No.
So they're not supposed to be in here, but they are typically found in temperate deciduous forests near suburban areas and urban landscapes. So it's absolutely possible if there are people who have them as pets, it's absolutely possible that you could have seen some in the area, because obviously... Because
I could have sworn I've seen like a couple here through the, like...
Right. But so, I just read that part if you want to say anything else about that, Mike. That stole that last line from you.
That's about it. That's what we have today.
You have a good day at school? I know it was long, but...
It was a long and tiring day, but it was pretty decent.
Glad to hear it. All right. Thank you, Arthur. That was an awesome corner. I appreciate you edumacating us on all of that.
Mm. Now, you want to take this next bit? It's a bit of a bit.
Yeah. I guess I got it.
Oh.
In 1894, Marie met Pierre Curie?
Mm-hmm. Pierre.
Pierre. Sorry, I meant Pierre, but it came out.
You're good.
My talking hasn't been great today. Anyways, who was then the supervisor for the School of Physics and Industrial Chemistry in Paris, and in a very short time, the two began to date. Pierre had a doctorate in chemistry, and the two talked often of their love for the sciences. That's so real. I love science. Anyways, on July 25th, 1895, the two were wed. Aww. That seems very short.
Well, people didn't live anywhere near as long as we did, so as we do now. So if they dated from sometime in 94 until July in 95, that's really that short.
Short in our eyes, I suppose. Almost immediately, the pair began working with radioactive materials, including radium and polonium?
Polonium.
Polonium? Okay.
Polonium, I guess.
Polonium.
Oh, the next line tells you why.
Marie coined the term radioactivity to describe the energy given... off by these materials, and named... Polonium. I can't talk today, guys.
Okay.
After her home, the homeland of Poland. I couldn't even say you or your this morning, so
you're doing great.
It began with Marie looking for a subject for her doctoral thesis, and she decided to see if the properties found in uranium were to be found in other materials as well. She discovered thorium?
Yep.
Thorium? Okay. And had radioactive properties. Also had radioactive properties. My bad. Though she discovered this at the same day as a German scientist, and it was
he who got the credit. That kind of sucks.
For discovering thorium's radioactive properties. I can't say it, but I did it. Anyways.
Being too hard on yourself, baby.
And... And we're, and then began to work with a material called pitch blend?
Pitch blend.
Okay. An aggregate?
Aggregate.
Aggregate material of multiple parts. Two stones in this blend, radium and polonium?
Perfect.
Were also found to contain radioactive properties. This discovery, as well as her husband's thoughts on Henry Becquerel's? Mm-hmm. Becquerel's?
Becquerel.
That's what I thought.
Oh, so no.
Discovery of radium and energy. And an energy that she dubbed as radioactivity was the basis for her husband's and Henry's Nobel Peace Prize in physics. Much of this work was very difficult, as there were no tested ways to achieve the things they wanted to try, and both had to do a lot of teaching to make ends meet while they performed these studies. Further separating pitch blend into its various pieces was arduous.
Uh-huh.
Arduous and time-consuming.
Perfect.
It took a long time for her to separate out the radium. She was never able to separate out the polonium due to its short half-life. Between 1898 and 1902, the Curies authored, either together or separately, 32 specific papers about their discovery. One of those properties they wrote about was when exposed to radium energy, cancerous cells were destroyed faster than healthy cells. Finally, in December of 1903, so about a year later, the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences awarded her, Pierre, and Henry the Nobel Prize in Physics. Initially, her name was left off the prize. However, a scientist on the board of the Academy reached out to Pierre and told him of the Academy's attempt to remove Marie from the award. Pierre made a complaint and Marie was added. This made her the first woman to receive a Nobel Peace Prize.
It's not
a Nobel Prize.
There is a Nobel Peace Prize. That's not what
That's a separate word.
Yeah.
I just want to say, yay for that other scientist for standing up for Marie. Because she worked every bit as hard as her husband, and she deserved to be recognized for that. Saying that,
well, not only did she work as hard as her husband, and we'll cover this a little bit later, all of this was her idea. Her husband saw her working on it, was so interested. He was working on crystals at the time. And he dropped his work on crystals to work on this with her.
Gotcha.
So this was her baby. He just pitched in.
I see.
And so, yeah, the fact that that this other scientist reached out, and her husband made the complaint.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's excellent. Because had her husband not been her partner in every way, I don't think it would have happened.
Right.
No, because they didn't want a woman to be successful.
Even in Paris. I mean, Paris was definitely more open? Is that the word I want to use? More
sexually aware, I guess?
Yeah, I think.
And so, yeah, women's roles and men's roles are a little less defined there.
Yeah.
But still, I mean, back then, there was still a big, oh no, we need women for this.
Right. Do we need to take a moment?
Yes. Yes, to hear from
a fellow podcast.
Yes, we're going to hear from our friends at Chat Tsunami. So, take it away, Chat Tsunami.
Welcome to Shatsunami, a variety podcast that discusses topics from gaming and films to anime and general interests.
Previously on Shatsunami, we've analysed what makes a good horror game, conducted a retrospective on Pierce Brosnan's run as James Bond, and listened to us take deep dives into both the Sonic and Halo franchises.
Also, if you're an anime fan, then don't forget to check us out on our sub-series, Shatsunani, where we dive into the world of anime. So far, we've reviewed things like Death Note, Princess Mononoke, and the hit Beyblade series.
If that sounds like your cup of tea, then you can check us out on Spotify, iTunes, and all good podcast apps.
As always, stay safe,
stay awesome, and most importantly,
stay hydrated.
Well, that's amazing.
Yes.
I definitely need to make some time and listen to that show more often. Thank you so much, guys.
You know what's ironic?
Mm.
I'm pretty sure I saw their podcast somewhere earlier.
Did it? Sure. You were just like scrolling through the interwebs and you're like, hey, who are?
They use a red panda as their mascot.
That's why you would notice, absolutely.
And the red panda is almost always in the ad song.
Excellent. All right. Well, Marie was tireless in her studies and suffered much to eventually gain that first Nobel Prize. In 1900, Marie was assigned to the École Normale Supérieure, a Parisian school, while the same year saw Pierre join the facility of the University of Paris.
Baby, I know you're not wearing your glasses, but that's faculty, not facility.
You're right. Faculty is correct. I apologize. I mean, it kind of is similar, though.
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry about that.
That's fine.
In 1902, Marie returned to Poland when her father passed away, so sorry for her loss. And in June of 1903, under the supervision of Gabriel Littman, she received her doctorate of science from the University of Paris. That same month, she and Pierre were invited to speak at the Royal Institute in London about their discoveries in radioactivity. However, because she was a woman, she was prevented from speaking and Pierre was forced to give the speech alone. We also need to take a moment and mention that Pierre initially was working on crystals while Marie was studying radioactivity. He became so interested in her project that he decided to help. So they were pushing her out, not allowing her to speak because she was a woman, when all of this was her idea.
Dumb.
He was always following her lead on this project, so him speaking in her place was obviously a bit of a snub. In 1897, the couple had given birth to their first child, Irene Curie, and in 1904, their second child, Eva Curie, would make her appearance. Pierre and Marie did not go to Stockholm to pick up the prize in person. Both of them were far too busy for that. In addition, Pierre was not comfortable at these events and was beginning to feel more and more physically ill. Oh no. Since Nobel laureates were required to give a speech, the two eventually made a trip in 1905, and the money they earned was enough to finally allow them to hire a lab assistant. When the University of Geneva offered Pierre a position on the faculty, in order to keep him, the University of Paris was forced to offer him a larger salary and the chair of the physics department. However, when Pierre began to complain about the lack of proper lab, the university gave him that as well. On the home front, Marie hired a Polish-born housekeeper so her children would learn Polish and often took them on trips to Poland as well. Meanwhile, many companies were beginning to make use of radium and its properties in various forms of manufacturing. Pierre and Marie had never patented their discoveries and so made little from them. In April of 1906, Pierre was rocking home in the rain. He slipped and fell under the wheels of a carriage. His skull was fractured and he died instantly.
No.
So sad. It is. It was very sad indeed. And I think she really loved Pierre.
Because, oh, yeah.
We know that she did have an affair later on, but she never remarried.
She had an affair?
Well,
so I was going to say, she can't have an affair. She's widowed. Now, if she had a relationship, sure, but it's not an affair. Her husband
died.
It's
technically an affair because the guy she had the affair with was married, even though he was estranged from his
wife. Oh, okay, that's a different. I didn't catch that part.
Oh, Pierre was married?
No.
Oh, Pierre just died. His dad is saying we're coming up on she's going to have an affair with a married man a little later on.
Did he know that he was married?
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah. We'll talk about it more then, but okay. The guy was one of Pierre's students. And he was married, but he was estranged from his wife. They were not living together.
Like you and I living in sin. There's no sense in even bringing up that he was married. It just makes her look bad.
Well, but it gets held against her later.
Obviously. She was a woman, the same idiot, that wouldn't let her speak about her discoveries. Also, don't think that she should have a sex life. How dare she, after her husband died and left her with two children.
I know.
It was sad. You know what, though? Maybe I should take a minute, recenter my calm, and we should hear a word from our sponsors.
I think that's a great idea.
I'm on it tonight.
Sponsored.
Thank you.
And hot.
Yes, it's getting a little warm in here. We have to turn off the air when we're recording.
So, in May, the University of Paris offered Marie the chair of the physics department, which she accepted, intending to create a first-class modern lab in Pierre's honor. This also made her the first female professor in the history of the University of Paris. In 1909, upset because the university did not build her world-class lab, the Pasteur Institute offered to hire her on and build her the lab she desired. Under threat of losing Marie, the university began to build her lab along with help from the Pasteur Institute. Eventually...
Yeah, that stuff works out, isn't it?
Eventually, they built the Curie Pavilion, which would become home to the Radium Institute, which would later be renamed the Curie Institute. Marie, however, never stopped working. In 1910, she successfully managed to separate radium out, and she even dropped a universal measure for radioactive output that was eventually named after her and Pierre. That measure is called a Curie.
Very nice.
Yeah. In 1911, the French Academy of Sciences failed by one or two votes to allow her into the Academy. It would take over another 20 years before a woman was allowed into the Academy, and it would be a student of Marie's. Wow. Another reason Marie wasn't allowed in was her Polish descent. France was rather xenophobic at the time and did not want foreign-born people in their institutions.
Poo-poo on those stuck-up French.
During the Academy elections, the right-wing press vilified Marie for being foreign-born, an atheist, or in some screeds, a Jew.
Oh, no.
I know, right?
How dare she?
Years later, her daughter Eva...
She can hang with us. We like Jews. It's all good.
Years later, her daughter Eva would call out the hypocrisy of the French press for highlighting her mother's nationality when she was up for a French award, and yet celebrating her as a hometown hero when she won international acclaim.
For Eva, go, little sister.
things like the Nobel Prize. In 1911, a scandal broke that revealed that Marie had been having an affair for about a year with one of her husband's students, Paul Langevin. This is rumored.
Yeah.
She was in her mid-40s at the time and 5 years Langevin senior. Langevin was married at the time, though estranged from his wife. The press had a field day painting Marie as a foreign-born Jewish homewrecker.
Nice.
Marie had been at a press conference in Belgium when the news came out, so she didn't know about it. When she came home, she was surprised to discover that a mob surrounded her house, and she snuck off with her daughters to stay with a friend until the mob dispersed. However, despite the scandal, the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences offered her another Nobel Prize, this one in chemistry, for her isolation of radium and her discovery of both radium and polonium. However, there were those in the academy that were worried about the Langevin scandal and tried to get her not to attend due to what they saw as her questionable moral standing. Marie countered that she would attend because the award was given for her scientific studies, which were not connected to the facts of her private life.
Amen. Tell them, girl.
She was the first person to win or share two Nobel Prizes and is one of the only two scientists to have a Nobel Prize in two separate disciplines. This second Nobel Prize got the French to commit to the Radium Institute, which would be complete in 1914. However, a lot of successful men from Warsaw approached her to try to convince her to return to Poland and continue her researches there. She refused. They later offered her a spot at the University of Warsaw, where they did not see the war. But she refused. She refused. It's a callback to what you did. It's comedy. Trust me, I know this. Hey. It's been 20 years.
You gave him the setup. It was a good thing. It's not a bad thing that he used that again.
But she refused to focus on the Radium Institute, except for a 14-month hiatus she took to deal with illness, as well as to head to England to spend time with her friend and fellow female physicist, Hertha Ayrton.
Have we talked about her?
We have not.
I feel like I've heard that name.
Probably. She's fairly famous. Not nearly Marie Curie's level, but
all right.
However, no sooner would the Radium Institute, now located on the newly made Rue de Pierre Curie, or these days that street's been renamed the Rue de Marie Pierre Curie, be created, then most of the brilliant minds who worked for the Institute were drafted for World War I.
Aw, man.
So, again, Marie's working her brain off, and the French are... And people from, and Marie is just, leave me alone, I'm doing science over here.
And I'm busy with my science.
She's slaying, she's eating it up. Oh, anyhow, we shall not talk about World War I. While she did very little scientific research during this time, Marie was quite busy. She realized soldiers would be best served by treating men as close to the battlefield as possible, and to that end created 20 X-ray units, as well as designed X-ray units that could be used at field hospitals. These mobile units were dubbed as Curies or little Curies. Is that right?
Yep.
It is believed at least 1 million men were helped via these X-ray machines. And Curie even began training women as aides.
Can you believe that? She made X-ray machines.
Yeah.
For the First World War. Isn't that wild?
Well, and think about this. Not even portable. Essentially, they were UPS trucks that were X-ray machines.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
That's Well, you can get it from, I mean, even when you go to get an x-ray, yeah, now, at hospitals, there are portable x-ray machines, but most of the x-ray machines that you see when you go somewhere to get an x-ray are literally part of the room. And yeah. She was doing that back then. That's so wild to me.
Yeah, and they did my x-ray on my foot because they wanted to make sure that none of my bones were broken. They were just like, they were moving it around, but it was, like, stuck in the ground.
Yep.
Anyhow. She was assisted in all this by a doctor and her daughter, Irene. She even designed needles filled with radium essence that could be used to inject and sterilize wounds. Ooh. This radium essence is today known as radon gas. She even gave her Nobel Prize money to the state to help them during wartime.
Wow.
The French government never thanked her for any of this.
Wow. I'm a little disappointed in the French government and their treatment of Marie Curie, but I know that women didn't get treated well anywhere in the world back in the 1920s, so I don't know why I'm so surprised. So, in 1925, 25 years after the discovery of radium, the French government gave Marie a stipend, one that had formerly been awarded to Louis Pasteur, who was the one who discovered how to pasteurize milk, that's why it's called that. In 1921, she did an interview with William B. Maloney, probably the most preeminent female journalist of her day, which saw Mrs. Maloney start a radium procurement fund for Marie Curie, as well as publicize her trip in the United States, where she was quite popular. In 1921, she visited the White House, where President Warren Harding provided her with a gram of radium, while the First Lady called her a prominent achiever who was also a supportive wife. In August of 1922, she was chosen for the League of Nations International Committee for Intellectual Cooperation, along with researchers such as Henry Bergson and Albert Einstein, among others. She was in some pretty good company.
Yeah.
In 1930, she was elected to the International Atomic Weights Committee and would receive numerous awards from around the world over the next few years. During this time, she also wrote a biography of her husband, Pierre, as well as laid the foundation for a radium institute in Warsaw that would be helmed by her sister, Bronislava. After a final visit to Poland in 1934, Marie Curie would pass away from aplastic anemia, thought to be a byproduct of her long association with radiation, which was conducted without any safeguards that later researchers would use. She used to carry test tubes with radioactive isotopes in her pocket and leave radioactive materials in her desk, commenting on their faint glow. Due to this, her notes are so radioactive that they are kept in lined vaults, and those who wish to access them must wear protective clothing. Even her cookbooks are highly radioactive. Originally, she was buried in the Paris graveyard, along with her husband, Pierre, although in 1995, they were both moved to the Paris Pantheon, where she was only the second woman to be interred there, and the first to be interred on her own merits. Their tomb was lined with lead due to both of their long exposure to radiation.
So far, so good. Well, unfortunately, she's dead, but, you know.
She was amazing.
Oh, yeah. And the weird thing is, she's alive while the radium girls are going on, I think. Didn't that happen?
That wouldn't surprise me. It seems valid.
But let's talk about her legacy. Marie broke down a lot of barriers for women in the scientific community.
She did. She's kind of one of my new heroes.
She also changed the way science perceives certain things, like their thoughts on energy storage. And as such, she changed the views on both physics and chemistry for her time. For her creation of the Radium Institute, she was often able to help other scientists. She gave away Nobel Prize money to friends, students, and institutions where she worked. She insisted prizes be given to the facility where she worked and not herself. She seemed to not know she was famous or particularly care about it.
Yeah.
Albert Einstein once said that she was the only person he ever met who seemed to be immune to the effects of fame.
That's pretty cool, though. That would be an amazing way to live, wouldn't it?
Yeah. In addition, the Nobel Prize she won with her husband and the one she won on her own were just the first prizes to be given to the Curie family, with one going to her daughter Irene and another one going to her son-in-law in what some would refer to as the Curie family legacy.
Pretty awesome.
Yeah. And, you know, I'm jumping the shark.
I'm excited about this show because this was a really, really good show. We've got a great, powerful, awesome lady. Next week, we're going to have a stinky, mean dude. But that's okay. We'll save that for next week. I'm going to jump because I'm talking right now and I'm going to tell you my final thoughts are that Madame Curie, she was pretty awesome, and I would have been glad to have her as a friend or as a sister or as a mentor. I'm nowhere near as smart, even in all of my 10 fingers and 10 toes, but I would just cheer for her glowing butt all day long. She was amazing. I appreciate everything she did for the world.
It's kind of funny that you put it like that. When I dropped the picture I have and asked people to guess what about our topic, someone quickly guessed it was Marie Curie, but someone else then later said, and you know, with our Facebook group, we got some hacks in there.
Yeah, so, oh yeah.
I don't know who said it, but she said, they said, this woman positively glowed.
And in the picture she does, it's like outlined in this green halo. There is no question. So weird to walk into a room and see someone glowing like that. Like, you'd be like, I don't know what to do. I'm terrified. Like, people would think she was a witch in the 1920s.
But she surrounded herself with scientists, and even some of them were kind of weird, because I don't get a scientist going, well, we can't have a woman speaking.
Well, it's because they were, it's like I was watching rewatching some of the most jaw-dropping episodes, and I had completely forgotten about the Jeffersons when the husband gets invited to a neighborhood watch meeting, and it ends up being a Klan meeting. And when that happens, he's confused and then angry, and the idiot who is like the head leader of this Klan stands there and has a heart attack because he's throwing him under the bus. And when that happens, Mr. Jefferson is the one who saves the man using CPR. And unfortunately, this bigot is just so pathetically sad in his life that when he is told, hey, he saved your life, he did CPR, the man says, you should have let me die. There are some people that are just so stone set in their ideals of how the world should be that they can't see the rope for the end of their nose to get out of the water. You know, it's so sad.
It's unfortunate.
It's like, and this is getting way off base here, but it's like there's a black man that goes around the country meeting racists, and he kind of forces them to befriend him.
Mm. Interesting.
I've read a couple of different articles about it, and every time it's like, they can't hate me. They don't know me. But it shows these pictures of him with these hardcore racists smiling, laughing, eating together.
I have always thought of racism as more of a ignorance in people. I don't understand how you can look at two humans in the same room and say you are more or less because of the color of your skin, because of the shape of your nose, because of the heritage that you come from. It seems to me, has always been to me, an ignorance that we have as humans, and something that a lot of us need to figure out how to get past. I don't care what your gender is. I don't care what your color is. I don't care what language you speak. You are my human brother or sister or non-binary or transgender or gay. You are my human sibling. And if we get out there in the world and there are other spaces, well, then we'll look at that. But again, that doesn't make anyone here better than anyone else.
Right.
Point?
It was, no, absolutely.
No, I wasn't making a face at that.
Oh.
And the thing is I like knowing that she broke down so many barriers, but not just that, but like she really changed science. I mean, mm-hmm. We wouldn't have the word radioactive without
it. Exactly.
You know? So I just think that's amazing the way that she was able to get in and change things. And then I know that I'm kind of jumping the gun on this, but like her daughter, like one of her daughters goes on to become an actress and a singer and lives in America. And the other daughter stays in Paris and becomes a scientist, right? But like her daughters are both these very strong, independent, successful women. Which, you know, makes me so proud. But, like, next week we're going to revisit Rasputin, and I found out one of his daughters was a lion tamer.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So, I guess the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, I guess.
Sometimes it doesn't.
Anyway, I guess my final thought is that I've always just known the name Marie Curie, and I knew she had stuff to do with radiation, and beyond that, I didn't know. But doing this episode, I was really impressed, very impressed with her scientific abilities and just how smart and strong of a woman she was at a time where that was not expected of women.
Yeah, absolutely. I think she was very strong and very just smart overall. She seemed like a good woman.
Yeah, and even if you want to look at the relationship she had with Paul Langevin, man. Her husband had been dead for, I think, around 4 years at that point. This was someone who knew her husband, that had met her with her husband, so they could share memories, you know, and thoughts. I don't see how, you know, that doesn't lead to some kind of a relationship. And especially with how open sex is in France, a sexual relationship seems obvious.
Yeah.
You know, but again, she didn't let that stop her. She's like, eh, that doesn't have anything to do with the science I do, so shut up and let me take the award.
That has absolutely nothing to do with my smarts. has something to do with the relationship that I have with people. And sure, she could have... Anything could have happened. She could have had a different reaction to that. She could have done this, done that, whatever. But things happen. And sometimes people just get together, even if they know it's wrong.
Yeah, well, and in the, I don't even think it's wrong if he separated from his wife anyway. Okay, then, you know, whatever happens, happens. I mean, that's just the way that goes sometimes. Final thoughts for you, my Arthur.
I don't really have much. All I have to say is she was a smart woman. She knew her way around a lot of things, and I feel like without what she had done, we wouldn't have a lot of what we have today.
Oh, absolutely. I agree with you 2,000%.
And women's rights would probably be even less in tune.
Yep. And that's our show. Thanks for listening. Thanks for keeping us in the Good Pods Top 100. Just saw that email again today, so thank you very much. Thanks to Bill Barrett. That last name is spelled B-E-H-R-E-N-D-T. Why am I spelling it? Well, I'll tell you why. Bill is the guy that does our theme music. That's why I thank him. But he is a professional musician, so if you need a musician to play an event or if you need music for a project, he's your guy. You can reach him at BillBarrett@sbcglobal.net. Now you know why I spelled it, don't you? Also want to say thanks to Paige Elmore, formerly of the Reverie Crime podcast, in addition to about 100 or so episodes of one of the best true crime podcasts you will listen to. Paige also has an addiction to Canva, which she combined with our own Arthur's artwork to create some logo art for us. Thank you, Paige.
Thank you, Paige.
Also, thanks to Aaron Gennert of the Big Dumb Fun Show. Please join our face group, moderated by our own Laura June Williams. Thanks to Blue Bows for being our sound engineer. If you want to chat with us, you can reach out to us at plot_family on Twitter, or you can email us at familyplotpodcast@gmail.com. Join us next week as we revisit the subject of our very first episode. And why are we doing it? Well, I'll explain that real quick. One, I've learned how to do research so much better than I did back then. Oh, my God. Two, Arthur is 5 years older? 4 years?
I think it's four. I think we started this when I was 11.
Yeah. So you're 4 years older now, so you'll have a different reaction to it. And then, of course... Laura was not with us on the podcast on that first episode.
Yes, that very first episode, I had not started with the podcast.
So, that should be an interesting episode. It really should. So, if you've heard our first episode, I think you'll like it. If you never have, catch it, because I think you're going to dig it. That's it. That's all I got.
Bye! Bye. We'll be right back.